Now I wanted to talk to you about the advantages of speed when it comes to bow hunting. And I'm not talking about ultimate speed. You have to remember where I come from. I come from the 80s. I started with a Darton 30MX in 1985. Some of you might remember that bow. Wasn't real fast. Graduated to some PSE bows. And then finally a Matthews in 1992. That was a Matthews standard. And I've shot Matthews ever since. So I'm a little Matthews biased, but it's because I've shot them literally since 1992. So a really long time. But throughout that progression, I shot a lot of indoor target competition. My first competition indoor bow was a Golden Eagle Monarch. It had round rounds, they called it. A very, very slow bow. And then went into the Matthews bows. And I've shot just about every Matthews model that they've come out with. And it shot 3D extensively. Shot around the country, shot pro, semi-pro, open classes. And really enjoyed that. And of course, 3D, you're looking for speed. But you also had that balance, especially as you got into semi-pro and pro, that balance that gave you accuracy at the same time. So I've seen this progression, and I've seen the hatchet cams back in the day. Extremely light arrows. I used to shoot an overdraw a long time ago with shorter, stiffer arrows, aluminum arrows. I think 2014s might have been one of them. But they were very light, thin-walled arrows to get that speed. And that was because the bows were really slow, and so you'd have this overdraw that allowed you to shoot a shorter arrow. Not something that I recommend, and certainly not something that's even really used nowadays in any real degree. So lots of ways that people have tried to speed up bows and speed up slow bows. I'll talk about speed here in a second, why you should look for a faster bow, not ultimately as fast as some of those hatchet cams or exploding bows and limbs back in the day. But speed to help you. And I'll give you an example. I used to shoot a PSE Fireflight. I think that was 1988 or 89. I would shoot that bow at roughly 76 pounds. It was a 22-16 arrow, I believe. And I even shot a 23-17 arrow at some point out of that. And that same arrow out of my Matthews V3 now today would go faster with my V3 at 62 pounds than that bow back in the day at 76 pounds. And the V3, of course, is a lot more accurate nowadays, a lot quieter at that speed. And I would be willing to guess that I could probably drop that V3 down to about 55, 56 pounds and shoot 20 pounds lighter, if not even more than that. I don't even have these arrows anymore to test it. But we did some testing today, and we'll talk about that, of the differences between heavy arrows, light, and slow arrows versus fast. But I'm going to talk about some of these benefits just real quick for you. If you're looking out there for a bow and you're trying to decide, you know, what does speed even mean? Because people out there will say, well, speed doesn't matter. It doesn't matter how fast that arrow is going, but it does. And there's several ways that it does matter. And again, I'm not pointing out that you should go out and try to get the ultimate speed bow, but I'm really urging you to try some balance. And this first one is really important. And I notice it as I'm 51 years old and, you know, I feel pretty good. My shoulders feel good. I don't feel like there's any damage when I'm shooting. I used to shoot thousands of arrows a year, 70 pounds for competition. We had these back in the day, they called them line jammers. They were big, heavy carbon arrows. So I'd have to shoot 70 pounds and I'd shoot that all summer long. And I'd shoot tournaments all around the country. And it was, you just wanted to shoot that big heavy arrow accurately and try to get that line cutter to get a higher score. So, you know, I've done that. I still feel pretty good. So that's a good thing because some people's shoulders wear out. But when you're just considering draw weight, I want to point this out. And this is just an average. It'll be different if it was a really high strung bow, a heavy bow, or a light bow, but just an average, for every 2 feet a second faster that a bow is, and you have to compare apples to apples, whether you're comparing IBO speed or AMO speed, whatever it might be, you're comparing apples to apples to look at a speed and try to guesstimate that hunting range, because that hunting range is not going to be that ultimate IBO really fast speed. It's going to be something more moderate. But for every 2 feet a second faster that a bow is, you can drop your draw weight about a pound and equal the same speed with the same arrow. So one bow that is 20 feet a second faster than the other with the same arrow, same draw length, is, you can shoot that bow about 10 pounds lighter and still get everything the same. So think about that when you're hunting in the late season. And think about that. You bought this slow bow because, quote, speed doesn't matter. And then you get into the late season and you have this buck of a lifetime walk by. And I've had a friend that this happened to in December where he just simply couldn't pull his bow back. And you get stiff. You're maybe not shooting your bow as much, although you should as the season progresses. But you get in those cold temperatures and you've sat a couple hours, you're really cold, you're frigid, you're shaking a little bit, and you want to pull back straight and not spook the deer that's in front of you, and you just simply can't pull back. So think about that. A bow that's 30 feet a second faster will allow you to drop 15 pounds of draw weight. So if you're used to shooting 65 pounds and you're going out and shopping bows, and one bow you're looking at is 20 pounds faster than the one you have right now, you can actually shoot that same bow 55 pounds instead of 65 and get the same performance, the same arrow speed, and that could be a great benefit. It's not only a benefit to pulling back that bow when the moment of truth arrives and it's really cold, but it's also a benefit for just shooting more comfortably. And if you're shooting more comfortably and you can hold more comfortably because you're not straining to get that bow back, then you're going to shoot more accurately and have tighter groups. So that's number one, really important. Think about that. That's probably the number one factor in there where you can just simply drop your bow weight. But number two, if you don't want to drop your bow weight, then obviously that faster bow, if it's the same level of accuracy, you know what's crazy? I shoot the Matthews bows, obviously, and you can notice that they're whisper quiet and every model is a little bit quieter. And they do that with decibel readings. And so what's cool about that is it seems like every model, and I'm going back to the NOCAM to the Halons, it was a big jump in speed, but the Halon 32, and then they had the Triax, the Vertex, and all the way up to the V3 right now, the VXR was in there, but each one got a little bit faster, but they got a little bit quieter. And that's that technology changing. And what they've done is make bows more efficient. So instead of having all that stored energy that was wasted in the limbs and the cams and the riser and your rest, your sight back in the day, and that bow would explode because it can't take it, they put more and they harness more energy into that arrow so that they can actually take less energy, less stored energy, and create a faster arrow more safely, more accurately, less vibration, quieter. And that's what where the advancements have come in the last 20 years. I mean, big difference. And you know, a lot of bow companies make high quality bows, the machining tolerances are amazing, but that technology equals more energy into the arrow, which equals great things for you. And where that comes from is if you have that higher energy and you have that faster bow, then obviously whether you believe penetration comes from kinetic energy, heavy arrows, whatever, it all equals a number somewhere that you can compare from one bow to the other. And obviously if it's a faster bow and everything else is equal as far as accuracy and being quiet, then you're going to get greater penetration. So that's a really good thing. And whether, again, someone will say, well, kinetic energy doesn't equal penetration, and I understand that. I mean, obviously if you're shooting a blunt field point at the side of a deer, it doesn't matter how fast it's going. It might hurt the deer, it might even break a shoulder, crack it, but you're not going to get into those vitals, obviously. So I understand some truth to that, even though you might have very high kinetic energy. But bottom line is, even if you just want to keep your bow at the same draw weight, you can get a lot more energy and greater penetration and more humane kills just because that bow is faster. Again, we're not talking about super light arrows. We're not talking about cranking that speed up and damaging the bow and getting into that situation. Number three, trajectory. This is an interesting one because I think this is something that a lot of folks don't think about, because folks will say, hunters will say, well, I'm only going to shoot 20 yards or 25 yards. And that might be great if you're in a northern setting, you're shooting over a bait pile and there's just no way to shoot anywhere else. But a lot of people are hunting unknown distances in the woods. I don't hunt food plots very often, so I have to range various trees around me. And it's almost always a moving target because you don't know exactly where that buck is going to come in at. You can predetermine that to some extent, especially on private land. But for the most part, you're shooting unknown distances. And someone who will say they won't shoot past 30 yards, but there's a buck of a lifetime at 33 yards or 34, they're going to take that shot, and they might not even realize it's 33, 34 versus 29 or 30. In the heat of the moment, things happen. We can't always make clear decisions. What we did today is we took my bow. It's 62 pounds, it's 27 inch draw. I have little stubby arms, so I'm not generating a lot of speed because of that right off the bat. But 430 grain arrow, which is, you know, roughly 7 grains per pound with that setup, so a moderate, more balanced setup, but it'll travel about 282 feet a second. Now, that bow with those 430 grain arrows sighted in at 30 yards is dead on at 30 yards. Now, I take three other arrows, they're green fletched, that Dylan's probably showing you in the B-roll here, but they're 650 grains. So we're talking about a 220 grain difference. Now, we didn't have the luxury of testing the speed on those, but through experience, about 20 feet a second per 100 grains, about 1 foot a second for every 5 grains of difference. So when we're talking a 220 grain difference, that works out to about 44 feet a second that we could plan. Now, maybe it's 49 feet, maybe it's 41, who cares? The point is it's a lot slower with a 650 grain arrow. The 650 grain arrow right off the bat shot approximately with the same diameter shaft, approximately 14 to 15 inches lower than the 430 grain arrows. But that's really not a comparison because you can just sight it in for that. But what we really wanted to test was how far that arrow dropped from a difference of 30 to 36 yards, both the 430 grain arrow and the 500 or the 650 grain arrow. And what we found was pretty stark. And we shot a lot of arrows to try to get this average and make sure we were correct. And we showed you a couple groups, but the difference was from 30 to 36 yards, shooting at 30 yards and just letting the arrow drop. We were back at 36 yards using the 30 yard pin and where it was sighted in. We found that the 430 grain arrow dropped about 3 inches. So only a half yard or a half inch per yard. I hope that makes sense. So we're shooting sighted in for 30, but we're shooting 36 yards. So that difference in 6 inches equaled about a half of an inch per yard. So I'm not advocating that you take that shot, but everything perfect, you're going to be in that 3 inch range off in those 6 yards at that distance. And I don't think that's outside of the ordinary. We're not going to compare it. The difference would be even more drastic at 45 yards or 40 to 46 or 50 to 56. We're not going to do that. But this is more of a hunting difference range, and that wouldn't be that much difference from 27 to 33, from 29 to 35, from 31 to 37. You get the picture. That's right around there. So a 3 inch difference. That means if you made a great shot, and this is where bow hunting, you just don't know, but you make a perfect shot, you guess right on the placement, the deer didn't move, you're gonna hit, and if you guess 6 inches off, you'll be 3 inches off, maybe 4 inches with your setup, whatever it is, but you're going to be still in that kill zone, as long as you're making a great shot. And that's that big difference. We don't know if we're going to make that perfect shot. There's a lot of variables. We're looking for forgiveness, you know, more balance. However, if you're shooting that ultra heavy arrow at 650 grains with the setup I have, 27 inches, 62 pounds, then you're gonna be off about 7 inches. And think about that, 7 inches. Now, if you're high 7 inches, that's in the spine or in the back. If you're low 7 inches, that could be in the top of the leg, in the brisket, in the extreme belly. So it gets it into a window where there's not a lot of gray area. There's not a lot of forgiveness with that arrow set up. And that's that difference in speed right there. You have probably about a 44 feet per second difference from one arrow versus the other. And that's just showing the drop of that arrow. And I know a lot of people don't like to hear me talk about heavy arrows versus light, but really you have to consider the trajectory when you're actually considering what is the balance of my setup and what it's going to be. But I urge you to test these things out for yourself. You know, sight your bow in at 30 with two different arrows, different weights, step back to 35 yards, step back to 40 and see the extreme difference. And of course we're using an extreme difference of 220 grains. I'd say, you know, it's not inappropriate to be at 500 grains with that setup or 520 or even 400. You know, that's still within a balance, consider trajectory. And this was, it was pretty crazy, that difference when we compared that in those common bow hunting distances. And you have people going out west that are shooting out 50, 60 yards on mule deer, even 70, 80. And so for whitetail hunters, around 30 yards, 35 yards, you need to consider these differences, especially with that trajectory. Now, number four, last but not least, reaction time. You know, maybe with that speed, same quietness of the bow, everything equal, then maybe that little bit extra speed will allow you to clip the bottom of the heart or the top of the heart or the top of the lung versus hitting that in the shoulder or somewhere else where you're not going to kill that animal. Sometimes a half inch, inch of point of impact makes a big difference with that arrow in if you're going to recover that deer. I'm not saying that it's unethical if you're using a 650 grain arrow. I'm saying it's unethical if you're considering that heavy arrow and that it's going to crack a shoulder every time, because it's not. And depending on the angle, depending on how that deer moves, it might crack a shoulder one time, it might not another. You're being very unethical if you think you're just going to shoot at that shoulder and it's going to go through. That's not ethical. Instead, making a good shot with a balanced arrow is being ethical. And this is where the heavy arrow versus light, heavy bow versus light bow, and certainly a faster bow versus a slighter bow, those all have to be considered when you're purchasing your next bow. Think about speed and how it helps you in lowering your draw weight, in keeping your same draw weight, but having better penetration, higher kinetic energy. And certainly the trajectory factor, you have to consider that. It's very important. And then of course, reaction time here. What does it equal? A lot of times a faster bow, and again, I'm not going back to the hatchet cant days and days where bows were exploding and they couldn't absorb the energy that was being stored within that bow. I'm going to more balanced, moderate setups that can give you that draw weight that maybe you want to lower, an easier time in the stand, ultimately more accuracy if you want to drop that weight, or better penetration if you want to keep the same. And certainly that trajectory, don't forget about trajectory. I probably should have put that at number one. But bottom line is, speed rules when it comes to bow hunting. That doesn't mean excessive speeds. Again, we're going looking at balance. But really consider that when you buy that faster bow, how much it's going to help you in the end. And as long as it's very accurate, it's very quiet, like my Matthews V3, the VXR, the bows you've shot in the past. And I can't tell you that Matthews is the best bow out there, because I haven't shot all the other 50 models out there, or 100, whatever it is. I can tell you I rely on that type of setup and that type of speed for not only my love of all things whitetail, but for my career, my profession, and just what I love to do every fall and what you love to do. And that's why you're watching. I appreciate you watching. Consider that speed when you're buying your next bow for this summer, this fall, or beyond. Well, I'm real excited, folks. I appreciate you watching this video, but my next web class, How to Plant Food Plots, How to Design Your Food Plot Program, is out. And it really goes through a step-by-step process for not only how to plant your food plots, but why you should plant them, where you should plant them, what you should plant, how you should create them. There's a lot of different modules. Ends up about 30 videos altogether. I urge you to check that out. We're out here completing our food plot work today, and we do that in a pretty strict pattern so we can find success this fall. Food plots shouldn't be a guessing game. Take the guesswork out of food plots and food plots planting, and check out the web classes. I have my How to Design Your Whitetail Property. The food plots were the next web class in the series, and I hope you enjoy it. I hope you check it out, and let me know what you think if you end up purchasing that, and I think you'd be well pleased that you did.